anniversary theme is renewed and soaring higher. And today God wants to make you aware. He wants to remind you of the price he paid for you to be renewed and to soar to the highest heights in God. You must understand that the devil is not going to sit by and allow you to become blessed by God. The more troubles he can thrust upon us, the more overwhelmed he can make us, he believes that he will stop our praise. For the Bible tells us that the joy of the Lord is our strength. The more discouraged he can make us, he will cause us to forget the word of God. To forget that God is faithful and that he loves each of us with an everlasting love. And during this season, for the Jews, it is Passover. For the heathens, it is Lent. For those of us who've done any studying, you know that Lent has nothing to do with this season. For us who are Christians and are washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, this is the time to remember what Jesus Christ did for us when he said the hour has come for the Son of Man to be betrayed. And so God wants to remind you that it is as a result of what Jesus Christ did that you are renewed, you will be renewed again, refreshed, and you will go to another level, another dimension, another height in God. And so for subtext, I'm reading from Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 to 14, and it reads, "For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." And I, for a subtopic, want to speak on valuing your redemption. Because if you understand what it costs Jesus, what it costs the Father to give you what you have today, to come down today in the midst of all these people, if this was in an Old Testament era, only Pastor Harris would be the anointed one. Only him would have the Spirit of God upon his life to anoint him to be the leader of this people. But today, each of us that is born again, on the inside of you is the same Holy Ghost. Amen. Now we must understand that Jesus' suffering began before he was scourged. Luke chapter 22 verses 44b tells us that Jesus' sweat was, as it were, drops of blood. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's praying, and his sweat is coming down as drops of blood. Now, why is this happening to Jesus? This description of Jesus' sweat is not ambiguous. It's not typology. Literally, the sweat that was coming from Jesus was sweats of blood. And when I did my research, it tells me that the mental and the spiritual battle that Jesus was facing that night in the Garden of Gethsemane was intense. For Luke 22 verse 44, it tells us, "Being in agony, he prayed earnestly." Amen. Now the time was coming. It was a reality. Jesus wasn't taking it lightly, although he was the Son of God, although he was God, although he was the Son of Man, Jesus was fully human as you and I are. So he knows by the Holy Spirit the time has come, and he's praying intensely. And the word agony in the Greek means a struggle, a fight, great exertion, anguish, pain, distress, and conflict. So Jesus is praying, and he's saying to the Father, "Father, if it is possible, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And so he is praying. The word agony describes the spiritual pressure that Jesus was under that night, because he knew that the hour was at hand for him to die for mankind. And so because Jesus' mind was under great emotional pressure, it sent signals of stress throughout his entire body, which made his body react as if it were actually under physical pressure.
Yeah.
For many of us, when we looked at the miracles Jesus did, when we understand who he is as God, we tend to think that Jesus was exempt from any pain. But the Bible tells us that we have a high priest that is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. It's like a man who is of the opinion that he might be sent to prison for life. He might be hanged, or he might endure some kind of beating for the wrong he's done. He's tense. And so Jesus is there in the garden praying. And what he's going through now has begun to send signals through his body to cause his body to react as if he's going through physical pressure. When this happened, it caused the first layer and the second layer of Jesus' skin to separate. Because remember, he's carrying the agony of the price he has to pay for the sins of every human being that would ever live.
Yeah.
Jesus knew that what he's about to go through, to even cause you this morning to be renewed, to even cause you to soar, to have a higher praise and a greater joy, it is going to cause him. And so the first and second layer of his skin began to separate, and it created a vacuum. And this vacuum caused the blood of Jesus Christ to clot and to seep through the vacuum and to ooze through the pores of his skin. And then it began to mingle with the sweat that came through his skin, and it flowed down his face as droplets of blood.
Yeah.
It was great pressure.
Yeah.
It was intense pressure. But Jesus had submitted to the will of God the Father that the church can have a joy unspeakable and full of glory. Because what you are expecting to experience this morning, and what the theme suggests, renewed and soaring higher, Jesus paid the price for you to have it. You can't buy your joy at the store. You can't buy joy on your credit card. You can't fake real joy. Sometimes we walk around with a pretend smile to make others think that all is well, but on the inside they're crying out to God, "Oh Lord, I need a touch this morning. Father, I need you to renew me. I need you to put a song in my mouth." This is what Jesus Christ died for. This is why Jesus was in agony. He came to fulfill every need in your life spiritually and naturally. And Jesus prayed with intensity. The Bible tells us that an angel was sent to minister on to Jesus.
Amen.
While he is praying, the Bible tells us that Jesus was arrested. He was arrested and he was held in custody by Roman soldiers and temple guards. Now these Roman soldiers were about 300 to 600 gladiator-like men. Remember, they're what we were called the military, the army. They were full of muscles and triceps and biceps. And so they're keeping Jesus in custody until Caiaphas, the high priest, is ready for Jesus. Now Luke chapter 22 verse 63 tells us that the men that held Jesus smote him. You see, when we read the Bible, we tend to think that Jesus was just given a little slap, a little tap on his cheek, and that was the end of it. But when you do your reading, you do your research outside the Bible, the Greek word for the word smote tells us that the kind of beating they gave Jesus was the grueling and barbaric practice of beating a slave. Those soldiers began to beat Jesus all in his head. face. It is what we will call today police brutality. And they're making mockery of Jesus. Remember, this is the same Jesus that walked into the temple and cast out the money changers. And he met them and he said, my father's house shall be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. But now Jesus is standing as a sheep before shearers dumb, and these Roman soldiers are beating him all in his face. He's black and blue, all in his face and in his head, and they're making mockery at Jesus. He paid this price this morning that we can enter into the presence of God. We can begin to cry out, oh God, let your glory come and fill this holy place. Let the presence of the Lord rise among us.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Immediately after Jesus was handed over to Caiaphas, the high priest, the scribes, and the elders began to spit in his face. All of them began to spit in Jesus' face. I don't know about you, but when someone spit upon you, that's the worst kind of insult. And I remember in Brooklyn, you know, you're walking around, and I would always look down on the sidewalk because I don't want to step into that.
Yes.
Could you imagine this Jesus that you love? This Jesus that is the lily of the valley. He's the rose of Sharon. He's the brighter morning star. Hallelujah. He is the great physician. He's the bread that came down from heaven. He's the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. And yet so they took your Jesus and they began to spit in his face as if he were a common criminal. But Jesus took all of that to of Abraham, the keepers of the law of Moses. We're not talking about the pagans and the Gentiles. We're talking about all the rabbis and all the scribes. They're spitting in the face of Jesus and they're striking him in the face. Luke 22:64 says, when they had blindfolded him, they struck him on the face and asked him, saying, prophesy, who is this that smote thee? And the Greek word for strike describes a slap that causes a terrible sting. So you can imagine, remember, Jesus was preaching. They were trying to kill Jesus. And they sent soldiers on guard to arrest him on more than one occasion. But this night they finally have Jesus. And now they too are slapping our Lord in his face until it stings. Could you imagine why his body began to experience that stress? Because Jesus knew in you in a little moment, they're coming to get me. And all hell is going to break out against me. You see, the devil was upon the priests and the Roman soldiers because Satan felt this was his opportunity to get back on God the Father for what he had done to him. When he cast him out of heaven, every demon and devil of hell was on duty that night. They began to possess and who they couldn't possess, they came upon. And Jesus was slapped by men that were infused by the devil to bring him hurt and pain. He stood there and he said nothing. And then in Luke 22:65 it says that they spoke many things, blasphemous things against Jesus. And the word blasphemy in the Greek means foul and unclean language. Could you imagine the leaders venting all those curse words, and they're beating Jesus and they're slapping Jesus in his face? That's why we have to understand that Lent has nothing to do with this season. Lent was a pagan festival, or rather still is, that was celebrated in the month of June to commemorate Babylonian Messiah called Tammaz. And it is said that the church at Rome adjusted the calendar and brought Lent in this season to take the church's mind off Jesus Christ. We've got to remember that it has nothing to do with Lent, but that a God that loved you, that cared about you, that our mother and father messed up in Eden. He said to the serpent, the seed of the woman, this very man and woman right here that you just caused to stumble is going to give birth to mankind that is going to die, that man can be brought back into Eden. And you are higher on our way to Eden. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? That's why Jesus took the beating. That's why he stood there as if he could do nothing, but he could have called legions of angels, and they would have come. As a matter of fact, when they came to arrest Jesus and they said, "We come for Jesus," he said, "I am." And then Jesus said, "I am," the power of God pushed them back up, and they fell to the ground, and they got back up again. And he said, "Who do you seek?" They said, "Jesus." He said, "I am." And the power of God knocked them down again. They did not arrest Jesus. Jesus handed himself over to the authorities, because the hour had come for Christ to give his life, that the church would live in the joy, the deliverance, and the prosperity of the kingdom of God. That's why he said, "I am come that ye might have life and have it more abundantly." Not only that, they plucked the beard of Jesus out. Isaiah chapter 50 verse 6. The Jews are known for wearing those long beards. Could you imagine the rage when a man can hold on to your beard and pull it out of your face as if he's plucking grass from the ground? Hear me, church. God loves us with an everlasting love, and we don't really value our redemption like we should. We read the Bible and we take it for granted that Jesus Christ came and died. But if you understand the price that he paid for you to have a brand name salvation, for you to be able to say, "I plead the blood of Jesus Christ, for there is wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb." The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews that the blood of Jesus Christ has a voice, because it speaks better things than Abel's blood. When we plead the blood of Jesus against demons and devils, the blood begins to respond and tell the devil, "You've got to back up. You've got to leave. You cannot touch this life anymore." That's why we can boldly declare, "Satan, the blood of Jesus Christ is against you." For the Bible tells us, if the rulers of this age had understood what they were doing, they would never have crucified the Lord. And full of glory. Yes. In spite of all you are going through today, you should never be discouraged, because of all the religions there are in the world, we are the only one that boasts that we have a God that loves and a God that cares. All the heathens have to take care of their gods, but God will take care of you throughout the day, all the way. He will take care of you. All the gods of the heathens are dead, but my God is not dead. Your God is not dead. He's alive, and he lives forevermore. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the first and the last. He's the resurrection and the life. He walks in the midst of us today. their idol gods. There are people that are bowing down to carved images that were made in China and the Philippines. But God is spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. For I declare like the prophet Isaiah that I see the Lord in Ebenezer today, and He is high and lifted up, and His strength fills the step. Whatever you need, whatever you want, God is here today to fix it. God is here today to strengthen you. God is here today to take you to another level of praise, another level of worship, another level of dancing, because He is able to deliver. Matthew chapter 27 verse 29, that after this Jesus was taken to Pilate and his soldiers, and these soldiers planted a crown of thorns and put it upon his head. Now once this crown was made to remain on Jesus' head, it began, the prickles in the crown began to pierce his forehead, his temples, and his veins, and it caused excruciating pain and bleeding. You see, the Bible tells us, if we want to share in the glory of the Lord, we ought to share in the suffering as well. And if you don't understand the suffering that Jesus went through, that's why we begin to murmur and complain when there's pain in our bodies and it doesn't move as fast as we want it to move. When we're in a situation of need and it seems as if Jesus isn't coming quickly with the bread and the money. But if you know the God that you serve, you will know that He's an on-time God. He is Jehovah Jireh. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, you're going to see it in the midst of the fiery furnace. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, you're going to see it in the lion's den. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, you're going to see it when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death. No evil shall befall you. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, you're going to see it when the pestilence that walks in darkness come, when you are hidden under the shadow of the Almighty, when you thrust under the wings of Jehovah. If you want to see the glory of God, you've got to walk through some trial, some temptation. There's going to be pain in the body. There's going to be problems in the home. But when Jesus comes, the tempter's bar is broken. When Jesus comes, all demons and devils will flee. When Jesus comes, night is turned to day. Sorrow is turned to joy. Hunger is turned to being full. Whatever you need, when Jesus comes, it is done. He took it. And then there too,
thank you, Jesus.
Pilate soldiers, remember the Roman soldiers did their bit. Yeah. The scribes and the Pharisees did their piece too. Yeah. Now he's taken to Pilate. Yes. And Pilate's soldiers, they had put a robe upon him and began to mock him. And put a stick in his hand like a scepter. And the Bible tells us that Pilate's soldiers took the stick that they had given Jesus and began to beat him in his head. Could you imagine the amount of bruising Jesus took in his head? And Jesus took all that we would have no mental sickness. Because remember, by the stripes of Jesus Christ, you are already healed. And as they began to strike him in his head, obviously he was bruised, obviously his skin broke, and blood is bleeding. Jesus took all of that for dementia. He took all of that for Parkinson's disease. He took it for dyslexia and bipolar, and all these mental diseases that are coming. If you understand the price that Jesus Christ paid for you to have a sound mind, for you to have the mind of Christ, that you will not be an idiot, but that you will walk in the wisdom and captures. He have them bound for head. But thank God today we bear the seal of the living God upon our lives. Our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. We are on our way to glory. We are not going down, but we are going up in the first resurrection. Heaven is our home. Jesus is our Lord. Experience police brutality. And then the Bible tells us that after all this, Pilate handed Jesus over to be scourged. He delivered him to be scourged before he was crucified. Matthew 27, verse 26. Now when we hear the word scourge in the Bible, we know it means beaten. And so we tend to think that Jesus was severely beaten, like the kind of whipping some of us got who live in the islands. When you got really good to sometimes you were black and blue. At least that was what I thought. That they got a leather strap and they gave Jesus a good set of lashes like an old school master would give you if you began to play truant or you didn't do your homework. But that was not the kind of scourging Jesus got. History tells us that the scourging whip was regarded as one of the most feared and deadly weapons of the Roman world. It was so deadly that the threat of scourging would calm a crowd or bend the will of the strongest rebel. Not even the most hardened criminal wanted to be submitted to the vicious beating of the Roman scourge. History informs us that the mere anticipation of the first blow will cause the victim's body to become rigid, the muscles to knot in the stomach, the collar to drain from his cheeks, and his lips to draw tight against his teeth as he waited for the sadistic, cruel, brutal blow that would begin tearing open his body. Now the scourging whip consisted of a sharp wooden handle with several 18 to 24 inch long straps of leather protruding from it. The ends of these pieces of leather was equipped with sharp, rugged pieces of metal, wire, glass, jagged fragments of bones, and it was weighed at the end with lead. So imagine the scourging whip, 24 inches long with leather, and then attached to the leather is metal and wire and sharp broken glass and jagged fragments of bones, and it is weighed with metal so that when that limp whip comes around, it wouldn't be a light lash but a strong lash. I'm going to go into graphic details because many people were afraid to watch the passion of the Christ, and some said it was an exaggeration, but it was as close as possible to what Jesus went through. Jesus was stripped naked so that his entire flesh would be open and uncovered to the beaten action torture's whip. And I'm using this as directed by the Holy Ghost to show you the price that Jesus paid for you to be renewed and to soar high. Because before today, all men outside of the high priest or the prophet were void of the Spirit of God. People served God in the flesh, so to speak. They followed the commandments in the flesh because there was no anointing or no Holy Ghost sitting on the inside, because the Spirit departed when Adam and Eve sinned in Gethsemane. Jesus has come to reinstate us, to renew us, and to take us higher, but there's a price that has to be paid. Yes. So he was stripped naked. His hands were tied over his head to a metal ring. And his wrists were securely shackled to the metal ring to restrain his body from movement. In this lock position, Jesus couldn't wriggle or move so as to try to avoid or dodge the lashes that were to be laid across his back. Jesus was then bound to a 2-foot-high scourging post. Once Jesus was harnessed and stretched over it, the Roman soldier began to put him through unimaginable torture. Two torturers were used to carry out the punishment, simultaneously lashing the victim from both ends. So I want you to picture two men with two rods, with all this bone and metal, it is made of leather, laid down, and they're coming at Jesus from both sides, and there's nothing he can do because they have him in a locked position. If he wanted to run, he couldn't move because now he's in a position that only the Lord can have mercy on him. As the jewel whip struck Jesus' body, the multiple lashes from the leather strap descended and extended over his entire back, curling torturously around his torso, biting painfully and deeply into the skin of his abdomen and upper chest. When Peter tells us that by his stripes we are healed, Jesus took these stripes to their sins of God. Whatever's wrong in your knee, whatever's wrong in your body, whatever asthma, whatever high blood pressure, whatever ailment you came in here with today, I want you to understand that this is the price that Jesus Christ paid, that you can walk out of Ebenezer healed, that you can get up on your feet and begin to dance and begin to praise God because of strength he took before your healing. When you go to the doctor and he can't figure out what is wrong with you, when the doctor says we have a name for this but there's no cure, when modern medicine has failed, you've got to remember that Jesus took these stripes in his body. Remember the two torturers bits are coming front and back, and they tell us that when the torturers pounded Jesus' body, that the pieces of metal and glass and wire and bone that was attached to the whip, that it sank into Jesus' body, and then the torturer would jerk back and pull and rip pieces of flesh out of the body of Jesus Christ. Each piece of metal ripped deeply into Jesus' skin and flesh, and it shredded his muscles and his sinews, his back, his buttocks, the back of his legs, his stomach, his upper chest and face was disfigured by the slashing blows of the whip. Isaiah 53:7 tells us he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Could you imagine? Listen, this is not a fairy tale. This is not Hansel and Gretel. The Lord, your creator, your God, the one you call your redeemer, the one you call your provider, the one you call Jehovah Jireh and Jehovah Nissi, he was stretched over Paul. He was shackled and couldn't move. And two Roman soldiers from the front and the back took those whips, and when they began to lash Jesus and the metal grabbed hold of his body, they would jerk back and rip up Paul, and they pulled the flesh off Jesus' body. The flesh was bled off Jesus' body. His guts came out. His spine was out. His muscles and his sinews. And Jesus stood there and he said not a word, because you people that are going awry. All the prayers for your sons and daughters, God, children and grandchildren. That's why Jesus took the beating. Money could not buy our salvation. Jesus took the beating. The mutilation of Jesus' back by scourging caused his spine to be exposed, his bowels to spill out through the open wounds created by the whip, and his flesh was flayed off his body. Have you ever gone to the fish store and you said you want fillet fish? You don't see the bones, you just get the flesh. They took the flesh off Jesus' body. Are you hearing me? Jesus came to die. He came to give his blood that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Whatever you are going through today, Jesus Christ paid the price that you can have a better life. Isaiah chapter 52 verse 14 tells us, many were amazed when they saw him. His face was so disfigured, he seemed hardly human, and from his appearance, one could scarcely know he was a man. Are you hearing the Spirit of the Lord this morning? His mother was standing by, and she saw what was done to her son, but she could do nothing, because the day he was dedicated to the Lord, it was prophesied to Mary that a sword would enter her bosom. And that day, she actually saw what they did to her son. All the disciples who were not in hiding were hiding on the scene as he stood there and allowed the Roman soldiers to mutilate his body. Why the Jews? Remember, he had said, I've come to the lost sheep of Israel. Remember, he told the Syrophoenician woman he couldn't take the children's bread and cast the dogs. And now the children that he had come for said, crucify him, away with him, give us Barabbas. But Jesus took all of that because you and I were on his mind. Isaiah 53:2 tells us, when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we shall desire him. My Lord, my God.
Ah, yes, God.
But so many blood vessels sliced open by the whipping, Jesus experienced profuse loss of blood. And bodily fluids made his heart pump harder and harder as he struggled to get blood to the parts of his body that were bleeding profusely. His heart is overworking. All his veins are broken and it is trying to get the blood there. I could see the grace of God just keeping Jesus alive, because it tells us that other people who were helpless to escape would scream for mercy in the hope that the agony will come to an end. Some people would even die on the spot. Listen, Jesus Christ was the greatest blood donor ever. There are many people who have been kept alive by human blood, but the blood of Jesus not only keeps us physically alive, but it keeps us spiritually alive. For you are not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold, but it takes the precious blood of Jesus Christ, blood that is better than Abel's blood or the blood of bulls and goats or rams. Jesus Christ came to give his blood. That is why it hurts the heart of God. When we trample the blood of Jesus Christ on the foot, when we walk into a bed of fornication and adultery, when it is a light thing for us to lie and to slander, when it becomes a light thing for us, for me to cast off God, do you know the price that God pays for you to be redeemed? And you're going to let somebody cause you to walk out of the house of God because this person don't like you, or they didn't elect you to be the head of a department that is trampling the blood of Jesus Christ on the foot. It doesn't matter who loves you, God loves you. Once I write a say, I was just born to serve the Lord. And then I look back to where I came from, the districts I was raised up in, and where I am today. I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for salvation. Then they say over the news that the air statistics is increasing. I don't have to worry because I'm covered under the blood. I dwell in the secret place of the Most High God. I don't have to fear sexual sickness and disease because my life is hid in Christ and God. I don't have to fear being rejected by a man in a relationship because Jesus is the love of my soul. The bishop and the overseer of my life. I've got a joy that the world didn't give and the world can't take it away. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with marriage, but we've got to get it right. If you want real joy, it can only be found in Jesus. If you want real pleasure, it can only be found in Jesus. Whatever you want, it is in God. You see, I've had my days of being a silly woman. I've had my days of being hoodwinked by the enemy. But I know better now. Whatever you are looking for is in Christ. You don't have to worry about stray bullets and gang violence. Or you belong to a different army. An army that is unknown to be power to bind and to loose, to decree and to declare, to superimpose the will of God in the earth. Or you don't have to get pretend joy. You don't have to use drugs to get a hug. All we have to do is to come into the presence of the living God and say, Father, I come. Hallelujah. Oh Lord, let your spirit come and fill this holy place. The reason why people die of drug overdose, they're trying to get another high. But I've come today to tell you, you can soar and keep going higher and higher and higher because Jesus took the torture that you can have joy. Jesus endured the agony that you can have peace. Oh, hallelujah. You don't have to pretend today. You can come to the man of sorrows and creative and grief, who was wounded for your transgressions and bruised for your iniquities. And watch God turn things around. Watch God give you what you really need. Loss of blood caused Jesus' blood pressure to drop drastically. Massive loss of bodily fluids caused Jesus to experience excruciating thirst. That's why he said in John 19:28, I thirst. You see, Jesus wasn't beaten according to Jewish law, but he was beaten according to Roman law. And the Romans did everything possible. They were brutal, unkind, and barbaric to Jesus. And after all of Jesus' flesh is off his body, his guts and his spine is out, they took the old rugged cross. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction to me. For it was on that cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. And they put it upon him. And they tell Jesus he must carry this cross. His guts is out, his spine is out. His blood pressure is dropped and he's thirsty. And they tell him you've got to carry it. Because none of us care about you enough to do it for you. Until they made Simon of Cyrene carry the cross. And then when he got to Calvary, the cross was taller than Jesus was. The Bible says they stretched to fit the cross. And all of his bones were out of joint. Have you ever had a slit? make this an arm or anything slip out. I've heard people talk about the bed. All of Jesus' bones were out of joint. They stretched in. Could you imagine stretching a human body as if it is elastic? Bones can't stretch, but they stretched Jesus' body. And after they did that, they put the nails in his hands and the nails in his feet. And then they raised the cross. And when they raised it, they dropped it in the hole, causing further ripping and tearing of Jesus' body. And the Bible tells us, for the joy that was set before him, he despised the shame of the cross. Amen. Evangelist, what joy could there be in such a scourging and a crucifixion? He looked ahead and saw you and I.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
He saw the souls that would be redeemed,
yes,
by the shedding of his blood.
Amen.
He saw the victory the church would live and operate in, because the cross is our symbol of victory.
Yes.
It was a joy to Jesus,
yes,
to do that for you.
Thanks.
And for me.
Hallelujah.
The Bible tells us that not one bone was broken. But while he was hanging on the cross of position, he began to suffocate. And he would have to try to push his body up, get some air, like a drowning man, and then go back down. And every time he fell like he was going to die of suffocation, he would come up and breathe and then go back down. And while Jesus is doing all that, he's taking care of his mother. Because he was the eldest son and it was his responsibility to take care of his mother. And he handed her over to John. And when Jesus had finished the very last thing that he was to do, he said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. It was only after he died that the people that crucified him realized that truly he is the Son of God. What is God saying to you and I today? I paid the price for you to be renewed. I listened this morning as you talked about being discouraged and distressed. Oh my God, the plethora of tragedy, of sickness and disease in the body, problems in the home and children, and outside of the church, gang violence, and all the things that are going on. But there's a God that came over 2,000 years ago, and he stood in the gap as a mediator to work things out for you and me. We don't have to struggle today with the pain of separation. You don't have to live in fear that the devil is going to get his hands on your sons and daughters and you are not going to get them back. There's no need for any of us this morning to be discouraged, because Jesus died to be my capture. I want you to really hear and believe today, because sometimes we become so used to hearing the same thing that it passes over our heads. But God wants you to know that Jesus took all of that for you to be renewed. Acts tells us when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there was a renewing. 120 people got a joy that comes from the Holy Ghost. Oh, I cherish you, O Lord, in cross this morning. I treasure the power that there is in the cross. And I know that there's power in the blood of Jesus. You know, sometimes we don't even want people to know what we are going through. But God knows what you're going through today. Sometimes what you're going through is so unusual that others would tend to think that you're sinning. That if God was with you, you would not be going through this. But to whom much is given, much is expected. I've been sent here this morning by God to be a channel of blessing to you. And if you really want to be renewed by the Holy Ghost, if you want to soar higher, listen to me. I'm a human being just like you. I have tests and I have trials. Sometimes in my life, literally, there's nothing to rejoice about. There's nothing to be happy about. Because there are all kinds of circumstances going on. But you know what I rejoice? Even more than there's nothing to rejoice about. Because I trust the God of my salvation. I don't have to be happy to be happy. Circumstances don't make me happy. Jesus died to keep me happy. And whatever seems impossible to you today, some of you might not be sure if the landlord is going to let you get back into that apartment. It might be a matter in the courts. It may look like the law is out of your favor, or the individual is in a position to swear the judge and the jury in their behalf, but you've got a God that nobody can tell God no to. I want you to stand with me today.